Folks, we are inside the famed Alamo Dome in San Antonio, Texas. Time to move all in. The Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship, Oklahoma, and the amazing Missouri Tigers. Can you believe it? When you look at the BCS standings, the Tigers are number one. And tonight, a chance to avenge their only defeat of the season at the hands of Oklahoma and Norman. Welcome, everybody. With Kirk Herbstreit, I'm Brett Musburger. A little bit later, we'll hear from Lisa Salters and the old linebacker, Chris Spielman, down in the field for us, too. But, Kirk, let us start with Missouri. Can they win the rematch?
Well, the last couple times they've gone up against Oklahoma, and the number one problem they've had is protecting the football. They've had 8 turnovers in the last 2 games. So the number one priority for Missouri tonight at Chase Daniel, protect the football, and they can go toe-to-toe with Oklahoma. In fact, I think they gained a lot of confidence the first time around in Norman against the Sooners.
And don't forget Sam Bradford. What a quarterback matchup we've got.
Wow, this is going to be exciting. If you like offensive football, 2 of the hottest quarterbacks coming in. Sam Bradford's a quarterback that will have to be able to have his offense establish the run, and then he'll try to go over the top of the Missouri defense by throwing the football downfield to Malcolm Kelly. Now, of course, Chase Daniel, we know all about him. We saw him last week against Kansas. Brent, I don't know if there's a hotter quarterback right now in the country with more confidence and more bravado than what Chase Daniel has to offer this Missouri team.
So settle in, folks. The big one is still to come. Who will be headed to New Orleans for the BCS championship? Who will celebrate tonight in San Antonio?
Let's go to Lisa Salters for an update.
Now, I spoke to Chase Kaufman during warm-ups, and he told me that even though he really wants to play, that he doesn't think he's going to be able to because that right ankle, the one that he re-injured last week in Kansas City, is still very sore. On a pain scale of 1 to 10, he says it's about a 5 when he jogs, and it hurts a lot more when he tries to do anything else. Now, the news is better for Oklahoma fans. Defensive end Austin English warmed up with the rest of the team. It looks like he will give it a go tonight. This will be English's first game back since breaking his right ankle earlier this season. You can see that that right ankle will be very, very heavily taped tonight. But Bob Stoops was telling me about an hour ago, he said hopefully once the adrenaline starts flowing, that any lingering soreness that English may feel will be blocked out.
And Lisa, for Stoops, 6th title game with OU in the last 8 years, and he's won 4 of 5. Familiar territory for him indeed. And to Gary Finkel, the first time that he has played for the Big 12 championship. Ranked number 1. An amazing season. One of those feel-good stories of the year. Fans from both sides are here in force. And right away, Bob Stoops and OU will tip its hand about what they're going to do with Jeremy Macklin, the deep man number 9. Garrett Hartley has put the ball on the tee. Will he pooch it? Or will they kick it to him and try to light him up with their great speed on the special team? We're about to find out. They're going to take it his way. Here comes Macklin against the speed of OU. Macklin's got a seam middle out to the 30-yard line. And for Chase Daniel, folks, he came here with the great high school team. Carroll High School from South Lake suffered his only defeat right here, Kirk.
Well, Chase Daniel, as I said, one of the hottest quarterbacks in all of college football, going to go over 4,000 yards tonight on this season. What more can you say? Forget the numbers. The intangibles are so important to Chase in his game, and they turn to him for the leadership for the Tigers.
Field spread, 4 receivers, but Tony Temple, 22, who did not play in the first game in Norman, is alongside Chase in the backfield. OU brings 5. Dropped. Macklin drops the first pass of the game. Now, today's starting lineups presented by Dr. Pepper. Kirk talked about Chase Daniels. We've mentioned Jeremy Macklin. 2 fellas who made the All Big 12 team.
Well, this is a group of receivers that is as good as I think you'll see in the country. And, of course, the big offensive line led by Adam Speaker up front.
2nd down and 10. Well, wanted to throw it again, but Nick Harris, an outstanding defensive back for Stoops, read that play all the way, and he blew up Tommy Saunders. What a great play by Harris.
Brent, you're exactly right. Nick Harris not only does a great job of reading this play, but getting around Martin Rucker because of his quickness, he's allowed to do that. But the interesting thing here late is I think Saunders got rid of the football, and because he was outside of the pocket, it is not a problem as far as having intentional grounding.
Third down for Daniel and Mizzou. Gets it off. There's their initial first and 10 as he's able to fire it downfield. His second completion of the night, Macklin the receiver.
There's the accuracy of Chase Daniel. In fact, his first pass went right through the hands of an intended receiver. This time Macklin one-on-one in his zone against Lewis Baker, who's got great speed. But if you're Chase Daniel and you look out and you see one of your top players, Macklin, isolated with a linebacker, you'll take it every time.
Here comes Daniel. Firing a screen to Macklin, and Macklin back to the line of scrimmage. And again, the Sooners are all over number 9.
Well, they're going to be all over him throughout this game, Brent. It's not only the speed, but it's disguising their looks, blitzing from different angles, trying to confuse the offensive line, and trying to get after and get into the mind of Chase Daniel. The way that I'm seeing Missouri respond is not just quick throws, moving the pocket, and I still feel you'll see Tony Temple, number 22, who missed the first game against the Sooners, still come into play to try to slow down that pass rush.
Third and 3. Can Daniel and the Tigers pick it up? High and incomplete. They cannot. And a flag on the play. And Stoops unhappy with this call against Franks.
Pass interference on the defense, number 15.
Bob Stoops is livid right now. He had, right, what I'm seeing is Martin Rucker at 6 feet 6 inches, matched up with Franks at 5'10". He's got to win that battle. The ball is high. Questionable call there.
Questionable call. It was interference. I thought he wrapped him and hooked him with that left arm. Daniel. Great fake. And this time he catches Rucker underneath. Across the 25 to the 22-yard line.
This is the other way you try to slow down an aggressive Oklahoma defense. Receivers, whether it's Macklin or this time Alexander, look at the ball fake, taking his time, showing the poise, and trusting Rucker coming underneath. That's the thing. If you can give Chase Daniel time, there are holes in this Oklahoma secondary.
First and goal for the Tigers. Nothing doing on this. This was botched. So it'll be second down and goal.
I saw Tony Temple last week, and when he's in the football game, they just seem to have a different rhythm to him. Very anxious to have his chance to get on this field to take a chance against this Oklahoma Sooner defense. Brent, these teams are going to settle down and these offenses are going to score. And when you get opportunities in the red zone, you've got to score touchdowns. You cannot settle for field goals.
Jimmy Jackson, a sturdy backup running back, is going to come in right next to Daniel. They're going to fake it, throw end zone high, incomplete. Now, that probably will signal Jeff Wolfert to trot onto the field here and attempt a field goal. Folks, Wolfert has an amazing record going. He has never, as in ever, missed a kick in Big 12 play. 87 straight field goals and extra points. I mean, this former diver is doing a sensational job. Tommy Saunders is his holder.
Don't let him jinx you, Jeff. Lock in, kid.
It's 88 straight. Chase Daniel will take the field goal, but he's frustrated at the inability to strike for the touchdown. Mizzou leads it by 3. Wolfert with the ball on the tee.
fielded from the nine, and here comes Patrick. He owes Stoops one because of the penalty. And Chris, from down there, your vision down on the field, what are you seeing?
Well, one of the things Missouri's doing, Brent, is they're throwing that quick outside screen, and that's slowing down the pass rush of the defensive ends. Now, what I like to see both teams do on first and second down, you got to start slinging the rock down the field a little bit to open up the running game. They're not throwing it on first and second down. And Oklahoma's doing a great job of alternating their defensive linemen. And on pass rush, they are beating the Missouri offensive line off the ball. Keep your eye on Moldholt. He's sucking air right now. He's going to be struggling a little bit out there.
Slant incomplete. You got to be careful with Spielman on the sideline. He looks like he wants to go out and bop somebody.
I think he is. I think he's about to strap up, lace up the shoes and get out there and hit somebody.
Oh, boys, it's a different ballgame down here. And I'll tell you this. If I'm Oklahoma, I do not kick the ball to Macklin anymore. You don't appreciate his speed until it's flying by you with flames coming from his heat. He can put him up and let him go, man.
The problem, Spiels, is you forget who the head coach is over there in white. He's not afraid of anybody. Maybe it'll backfire on him. We'll see.
He's a brilliant coach, but he's not stupid.
Brown is the running back, and the pass was complete to Joe John Finley, his second reception of the night. Out of bounds in front of the Stoops bench on that side, Kirk.
And we talked about a series or two about the importance of Oklahoma's ability to throw, because Missouri's loading up the box with eight different defenders, very cognizant of Alan Patrick. Remember, the Sooners are coming off a game last week against Oklahoma State, Bedlam, where they ran for 307 yards. They got physical. They got challenged. And Missouri's aware of that, so they're taking that part of the game away, or trying to.
Third and four. Plenty of time complete for the first down if he gets this spot, and I believe he will get it as Chris Brown, the running back, his first reception of the night. And Witherspoon, fine linebacker for the Tigers, makes the play.
It's the kind of night you start that Sam Bradford is off to right now. He hasn't done anything spectacular, but he's completing passes, and he's making reads, and he's not making mistakes. We talked a lot about it this week. Which quarterback would avoid the turnover? Which offense would avoid the turnover? You have two quarterbacks coming in making great decisions, and Bradford there just dumping it down to Brown allowed them to pick the first down.
Pleasant's the fullback on this eye. He will lead the way for Brown. Brown got the most out of that run. Four tough yards, and William Moore back on the field makes the snap.
Important for William Moore to be back out there. Not only is he a playmaker, but talking about putting a lot of people up close to the line of scrimmage, William Moore is the epitome of that attitude. And he is probably the most physical defensive back that Missouri has. Now that Pick Brown is out for the year. They've got 10 guys within 5 yards.
Second and seven. Play fake. Bradford going downfield. Got Kelly open. And he hauls it in. It was overthrown a bit, or he'd have walked into the end zone. It was a fine catch by Kelly.
When you put 9 and 10 guys up to the line of scrimmage, you leave yourself vulnerable one-on-one. Malcolm Kelly against Terrell. And again, that is a matchup that Kelly can win every time. He's such a long strider. He just ran away from Terrell. And Bradford did a good job of leading Kelly downfield. That is a huge, our first huge play tonight for either offense.
47 yards. There are tight ends on the field now. Grisham really an H-back look as he's flexed off the line there. Number 18, he's a fine talent. And this is Brown. Number 29 has stayed on the field as the running back.
It'll end up being a cat and mouse game between the two coordinators. Missouri's defensive coordinator, Matt Eberflus, and the offensive coordinator from Oklahoma, Kevin Wilson, on when to take those chances. And by taking that chance, it forces Missouri to be cognizant of that and get their safeties back to respect that aspect of the Sooners' offense. And then the Sooners can get back to the bread and butter of running the football.
Second down and goal for the Sooners. Bradford drops it off. short of the end zone is Joe John Finley. He's been his favorite target here tonight. Time runs out on the first quarter. Oklahoma threatening, but Missouri leads it by a field goal. And the Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship returns after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Here's third and four, and both Kirk and Chris agree. Watch for number 18, Jermaine Gresham. He scored 10 touchdowns on the season for OU.
Remember Chris Brown in the first matchup between the Sooners and Missouri, also three touchdowns. He's tough in this area as well. If they get the numbers, they can run him.
Here it comes, end zone touchdown, just as you called. Brown, who had a big day, 13 for 67 yards along with those three TDs, and he bounces in to put the Sooners up for the first time tonight.
There are two players, when you talk to the Sooners coaching staff, that you can tell they're very excited about. DJ Wolf on the defensive side, and then Chris Brown, the sophomore tailback, who, as far as the media is concerned, has taken a back seat this year to DeMarco Murray, who's out for the year, and Alan Patrick, and Brown steps in there for a big score.
Garrett Hartley on for the extra point. This has not been all season long. That was perfect. I mean, that right downtown, wasn't it, as Brown scores the touchdown. Hartley adds the extra point.
Great blocking on the left side, and a seal block this time by Joe John Finley. And the vision that you see from Brown, he has an ability to pick the lane that he likes. He likes to cut back. And because Finley sealed that to the backside, plenty of room for Brown to go in untouched.
So Missouri averaging 41.9 points a game, and OU averaging 43.8. Right now it's 7-3 just inside, just starting the second quarter down here in the Alamo Dome. And there's the speedster. The redshirt freshman missed all of last year because of a knee injury from Missouri. Macklin's back deep. Deep in the end zone. Macklin cuts back, and he is down short of the 25-yard line. Moving the pocket to the left. Can't find anybody open. Throws it away, incomplete, as Rucker was breaking after Chase, had decided he's got to get it out of there, and they moved the pocket that time to the left. But what we didn't see in the Kansas game, we're seeing in the Sooners game. Oklahoma getting on number 10 in a hurry.
Well, they're not only getting on him and chasing him, but they're taking every opportunity that they can to physically make Chase Daniel feel their presence. Even if they don't get the sack, they're trying to hit him.
And that was English, the injured defensive end, who means so much to that defensive line. Number 33, hairline fracture. Missed three games. He's trying to get past that offensive line. Daniel throws high and complete. A first and 10 to Saunders. Big time third down pass, 21-yard gain.
Well, it started with the offensive line picking up the blitz, and then the bust here by Marcus Walker, who goes, he sinks to the inside on the slot receiver and completely loses Tommy Saunders, who comes up with a big gain. Great recognition by Chase Daniel.
First and 10. Temple battles his way.
Just watching the movement of this Sooner defense. Talking about a group that right now looks dialed in, very, very familiar with what they need to do as far as filling the gaps, running to the football. Great pacing and great attitude from this Sooner defense, and it's a defense for the most part has played very consistent with the exception of the Texas Tech game.
Daniel 8 of 14 for 70 yards. End around this time. They put the speedster to work for a first and 10. Macklin coming around. He was able to score down in Norman on that end around.
Another blitz here by Oklahoma. They're changing up the looks. Great block right to the right here by number one, Jimmy Jackson. That opened it up, and with the speed that Macklin has, after the blitz by Baker got picked up by Jackson, it allowed Macklin to get to the corner and to pick up another first down for Missouri.
Tigers inside the Sooners 45.
Anytime he's an empty, it's going to be a quick throw. He's got to get rid of the football.
Four-man rush. They twist. Moves the pocket hard to the right on the move. He'll have to put it down and take off.
Intelligence, savvy, poise. Chase Daniel, we just talked, Brent, about an empty set. There are no backs back there to help. And with the Sooners one-on-one, they're able to get by Missouri's offensive line. And instead of throwing it away, instead of taking the loss, he uses the speed and shows his versatility to pick up a nice gain.
So the 8 yards makes it second and two. Temple spins and he's short of the first down because of Reggie Smith's hit.
We just talked about
reaching up there. I'm telling you, boys, yep. He brought the plastic.
They are blitzing and they are coming up, and this time catching Tony Temple in a spin move. He's up in the air, and you don't want to do that against his secondary when they're closing in. That time it's Reggie Smith. Seven play drive so far. Missouri, it just seems that this is such an up-tempo offense. First downs are important to keep the defense on their heels. They want to dictate the tempo and not let this Sooner defense come after them.
Spread the field. You can see the receivers out wide. Daniel going to keep it himself for a first and 10. The middle is open up, and Daniel crosses the 15-yard line.
Five wide receivers spreads the defense all over the field. All you'll see is four Oklahoma Sooners down inside this area right here. Chase Daniel recognizes that and right away just decides to pick it up and take off with the football. And a huge gain, and the guy's got some quickness when he decides to run the football.
Oh, Daniel going to keep it again. Right up to the middle, to the end zone. No signal yet. I thought he might have gotten there, and they're going to mark it, apparently. Instant replay, probably going to take a look at this one. This was close, folks. Real close here.
Once again, Chase Daniel, this is a great job of just going in attacking this defense.
I'm going to tell you what.
Yeah, it was.
I think they'll stop it. Yeah, look at that.
You would think they would. It's close enough to stop. They're going to go to the pistol formation if they have to run.
And they toss on the pistol. Bang, and that one is short. That was Jimmy Jackson who checked into the backfield. They like to use him in those power running situations down there. And I'm rather surprised that the call didn't come down to give the booth more time to look at that. Regardless, it was right up on the end zone. But here we go again now for Mizzou. It is third and goal. And I'm sure OU this time is going to be looking for Daniel taking off on this.
Oklahoma's expecting that, already pinching in with their safeties and linebackers.
Here he comes. Well short that time. Never a chance. Fool me twice, shame on us. Fool me three times and he'll change the linebackers.
Granger, his quickness, 96, gets in there to penetrate. And how about Lofton coming off the slot receiver, expecting the run from Chase Daniel and took it away. So the close call on the long run by Daniel. The Sooners defense steps up and forces the field goal.
Wolford on to attempt his second field goal. 88 consecutive field goals or extra points in Big 12 play. Adds another one. It's automatic. But again, The Tigers failed to score a touchdown. OU has to feel good about this situation so far. Well, the offense huddling around, and my apologies to the booth upstairs. Clearly, Daniel did not get into the end zone. Watch him from this angle wrap the ball up as he goes down, and he is short of the goal line. And Chris Spielman was right there on the line, and he said that was a good call down there, so that we could see that there was no need to stop this game, and their eyes upstairs were better than mine.
And what a third down stop. What an effort by Granger and Lofton, expecting some kind of run there by Chase Daniel. But Missouri, in their last two drives, having to settle for field goals. That could be very, very important as this game goes on. 10 plays down to the Oklahoma 11. They settled for a field goal. And this past drive, 14 plays down to the one and another field goal.
Yeah, they had two first and goals down there. And this one is fielded at the five by Patrick. And it is time for the Dr. Pepper stats update. And we can see what has unfolded here so far. Two field goals for Mizzou and the one touchdown for OU.
Well, the shocking thing to me is to look at the rushing yards for Oklahoma and the passing yards. Missouri trying to stop the running game. Oklahoma's adjustment is to throw the football downfield. And if you look at right now the penalties, Oklahoma's got to settle in here and start to play smarter football. They cannot continue to self-destruct.
Sooners have a first and 10, and Brown, the Sooner running back. Play fake, Bradford. Moving to the right, picks up his running back for a first and 10.
And Bradford wanted to get the ball downfield, but instead he shows the patience, gets to the outside, and has a one-on-one matchup with Brown up against the linebacker, Christopher. Had a simple check down by the quarterback. They cleared out the rest of the secondary, one-on-one underneath running back Chris Brown against Brock Christopher, who just could not stay step for step with the tailback.
18 more yards for Brown. Only a couple of yards that time for Chris. And let's take a look now at the Pacific Life game summary. Missouri, as we have said all half, threatening a couple of times, but settling for a 28 and an 18-yard field goal. And then Chris Brown, who Kirk has been talking about, 17 in his last six games, and Daniel was stuffed.
And Daniel was stuffed. Granger made a big play there. Also Lofton. Chase Daniel frustrated, and has this where we are now. It's 7-6 Sooners.
Bradford is 10 of 13 for 120 yards. Moore showing blitz. Picked up. He was hit on the release. Incomplete. Pass intended for Iglesias.
Bradford will continue to take some shots. He's going to have to continue to take shots because his receivers, who are very talented, are isolated one-on-one. That's one of the ways to slow down a defense, and he is very fortunate that time to get the ball off because Shulock was coming off the edge from his blind side.
Third and 7. Comes the blitz again. Picks it up. Malcolm Kelly at the first and 10. Beautiful release by Bradford.
This is what coaches call zero coverage, where you just take a chance. There's nobody back in the back end. It's one-on-one. Malcolm Kelly and Bridges, the corner. Who's going to win that battle? Missouri brought the blitz. The protection was there, and Kelly got to the inside. And again, a nice throw there by Sam Bradford.
Toss play. Patrick back on the field. First and 10 across the 10-yard line for the Sooners.
I'm going to continue to talk about this, but this is what happens when you have a little bit of balance and you're able to dump the ball off to Chris Brown and throw the ball to Kelly. All of a sudden, Missouri's defense backs up, and all it takes is just a small little angle for that offensive line of Oklahoma to get the block that they need to create a scene for the very quick and explosive Alan Patrick.
This time, Van Alexander steps into the hole.
It's hard to run into a 10-man box. Missouri has everybody at the line of scrimmage. As good as Oklahoma is up front, and they average 6'5", 322 pounds, one of the more physical offensive lines in the country, but you've got 9 or 10 guys up there. Makes it tough.
Nice second and goal. Gresham's to the right of the formation. They're going to run the toss with Patrick. Patrick cuts toward the 5. Second effort and out of bounds at around the 3.
Gotta love Alan Patrick. When he gets on a roll, he starts to feel it. He is a very physical back for 196-pound tailback. And Kevin Wilson, the coordinator, telling him, they're going to be 7 or 8 or 9 guys up there. You've got to be able to make a guy miss and run over another one.
Huge, huge play for Mizzou's defense. Brown, the touchdown maker, in the end zone again for the Sooners.
Heck of a drive there, Brent. Nice job of mixing up the play calling, and at the end, it just comes down to who's more physical in the trenches. And a good seal block again by Joe John Finley to open that running lane up that time for Brown.
Here is Hartley. And folks, this goes back to the OU defense. 3 and out. They wound up giving Bradford a 50-yard field to work with. And the offense strikes for the second time. 14-6 Sooners.
How about the red zone tonight? We talked about it at the very beginning of the broadcast. Which team would capitalize once they got inside the red zone? And right now, both have scored. But Oklahoma, 2 for 2 with 2 touchdowns. And Missouri's had to settle for the 2 field goals. Difference in the game.
There's that Oklahoma swagger. If you want to bring it, number 9, come on after us. Not ducking anybody. And I'm telling you, I'd have been surprised if Stoops had done otherwise.
Remember, Missouri went 3 and out the last time they had the football. Chase Daniel and the Tigers, how do they respond right now with the momentum favoring Oklahoma?
Here they end around. Alexander's finally got the ball, folks. Out of bounds on the far side. Hasn't caught a pass, but Wolf has to track him out of bounds. First down and 10. Here's Daniel. This is complete again, and now they're moving the ball across the 45-yard line, picking up a 1st and 10, refusing to go down, and there's a penalty flag on top of this.
Personal foul, grabbing the face mask. Defense, number 8, a 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. First down.
Reynolds.
Yeah, Ryan Reynolds gets caught for it, but I'm just impressed with Martin Rucker catching this football and carrying about 4 or 5 Sooners down the field. And finally, as he goes down, Reynolds came in late and pulled excessively on the helmet and on the face mask of Rucker. It's a great call by the crew to see that coming in late.
It's 3rd and 11. Pressure running right. Reception going down was Franklin. Got it. 1st and 10 on the catch, working against Smith. Nice work by William Franklin.
And nice work by Chase Daniel. I thought he might think about early running the football, but Oklahoma thought the same thing. They brought pressure up the middle. Daniel gets to the outside, has the ability to get on the move, and then a great throw away from the defender where Franklin can go down and make the catch.
Terrific difference that Austin English, number 33, makes in the game. You saw him come free on that replay. Stands and delivers. Macklin, and he is across the 5-yard line. Now the clock becomes important. They've got 2 timeouts.
Plenty of time, 2 timeouts in this offense, 36 seconds, an eternity. Look for Rucker, 82, because of the size. It's off to the left, the inside.
We better hope it's an eternity. Chase Daniel, end zone this time. Touchdown, Mizzou.
What a big moment, folks, this is for Missouri, the number one team in the nation. Really, now with time running down, they finally score a touchdown and don't settle for a field goal. What a way to go into the intermission.
You want to get to the national championship game? You're playing for the right to get to the national championship. You're in your conference championship. You get down 14-6, and you have to show the ability to answer, and that's what they did.
Is it too early, Mr. Herbst,
I'd like to see a team kick the extra point. I think it's too early. There's going to be a lot of points scored in this game.
Yeah, you don't want to be chasing it, man. And Wolford is such a good kicker. It's a gamble. A lot of guys will say, don't take it if you don't have to. But let's see what happens. They can make it double. Reverse the throw from Macklin. Oh, yes. What a great call to go for two. How good was that? Oh. Rucker around.
You know
what? Smile on the coach's face. You know, he doesn't back away.
Brent, they caught him twice in the game. And Norman on the double reverse. This time they go double reverse and they end up throwing it. This is the touchdown. Look at the big splits here by the offensive line. In fact, the right tackle, Colin Brown, is way to the outside. And that's exactly where you have the ability to try to find a seam. And eventually Chase Daniel does it. That was a play right before the touchdown. Colin Brown moving to the outside, opened up a seam. And Chase Daniel finds it and gets into the end zone. But I didn't necessarily agree with Dave Christensen, the offensive coordinator, early in the game to go for two. But the call, the double reverse, they burnt the Sooners twice in the red zone in Norman. The Sooners were all over it to stop it. They were not expecting the double reverse pass to Rucker.
But working against the clock at the end of the first half, Chase Daniel, a Heisman Trophy candidate, gives the Tigers a shot. And let's go down to Lisa with Coach Pinkel.
Well, Coach, with the exception of that last drive, you had difficulty getting into the end zone. What was the difference on that last drive?
Well, we were in clock plan. Our clock plan, we changed the tempo up quite a bit. We threw some completions, made some plays, and fortunate enough to get that two-point conversion.
Now, about that two-point conversion, the guys weren't necessarily with you on the decision to go for it until they saw the play. What made you decide to go for it with so much time left in this game?
Well, our chart told us to go for two at this particular time, and we thought we had a good play on, so we went with it.
All right, thanks a lot, Coach. Good luck the second half.
All right, Lisa. Deadlocked at 14. Good one in San Antonio. Now let's send it to New York. John Saunders, Craig James, and a Flutie man for the Capital One Halftime Report. Take it away, John. We welcome you back to the Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship. Missouri and Oklahoma knotted up at 14. Mizzou, the number one team in the nation, trying to get to the BCS Championship game. And, Herbie, what a big drive at the end of the half.
Oh, an amazing drive. If you think about it, Oklahoma started to take control of this game on both sides of the ball. They're up 14-6, about 3 minutes, 41 seconds to go. Chase Daniel leads the Tigers down the field. 10 plays, touchdown. They decide to go for two. You and I thought it was a great decision. They get the two-point conversion, and all of a sudden they hit the halftime locker room, and they have the momentum and a tie game. The Sooners get the ball to start the second half. It'll be very interesting to see how the momentum is affected throughout this second half. And red zone again, I'm going to keep saying it. Who's going to get the touchdowns? And Chase Daniel showing a lot of moxie tonight for the Tigers.
The Sooners will start the second half with the kickoff. Jeff Wolfert with the ball on the tee. Fielded at the two by Iglesias, the wide receiver. Brings it out to about the 20-yard line before they take it down. And our Pacific Life game summary shows you the numbers here, Kirk, from the first half.
And you can see the passing yards up for Sam Bradford. I think that theme will continue in the second half because of their ability to throw against Missouri trying to take away the run. The penalties by Oklahoma, very alarming. 9 penalties in one half. Missouri, after having 9 against Kansas last week, only 1 in the first half.
Alan Patrick opens as the tailback. Bradford to Kelly. Kelly, 7 yards on that first down pass.
So if I'm Oklahoma, I want to get Sam Bradford in a position to throw the football. Throw the football and then get back to running with the physical running style of Alan Patrick. And they're the two quarterbacks and the nights that they have had. The numbers don't indicate how well they have really played. Bradford off to a pretty good start, 11 of 15. But Chase Daniel has done a lot with his legs to keep plays alive, with his scrambling and also scoring a touchdown.
Neither team has fumbled either, so we haven't had a turnover. Bradford complete as he slides it through to Joe John Finley, who's been active here.
So if I'm Kevin Wilson, the offensive coordinator, went through 30 minutes of football, had a chance to have my whole offensive staff study Missouri and what they tried to do. Here's Kevin Wilson. What I saw is a Missouri defense that's being aggressive and tenacious and loading up to stop the running game. I will continue to throw with Sam Bradford until they decide to back off, and then I'll start to run.
On first down, deep down the near side, Kelly, and he overthrew him, so it'll be second down and 10.
Bridge is locked on to Kelly about halfway down the field. I think he might have gotten away with a little contact there. And the only way he could prevent Kelly from going right by him was to get a little bit physical. I think the football was in the air. Missouri and Bridges caught a break there.
Gresham and Eldridge both on the field. Page back in the tight end look for the Sooners. Cheney, one of the wideouts now. Second down and 10. Came back with Patrick. And this will bring up a third down here for the Sooners.
Every game is big. Start the game with your drive, your opening drive, and then to get into the second half, especially after you make your adjustments to try to come out and see what you can do with that first drive. And with the score being 14-14, every possession matters. Every opportunity matters. And staying on the field on third down matters for both these offenses.
Well, here is a third and 6 now for the Sooners. Pocket's clean. Got an open receiver, and he's got it. Manuel Johnson's first reception of the night, and a penalty flag.
Personal foul, unnecessary roughness on the defense. Played it out of bounds, number 3. A 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
One of the first big mistakes, middle mistakes we've seen from this Missouri defense. Third down and long, a lot of crossing receivers. A tight end, Grisham, Kelly's crossing. When that happens, it takes a lot of time, and it's a great job of reading this defense by Sam Bradford, taking what they give him, and again, making a big throw, and here's a late hit by Terrell.
So on first down, they come with Patrick. Middle opens. He breaks free. Still going. 15. Cuts inside the 5-yard line.
What a job by the left side of the offensive line from Oklahoma. The first time they've really asserted themselves. Watch the kick out down here, and then the backside guard comes around, Brandon Braxton. What a job, what movement, and look how they open it up. And how about Alan Patrick and the quickness and acceleration that he has when he gets into the secondary.
Moore saved the touchdown, but a 40-yard run makes it first and goal. Brown pounds to the 3-yard line. Second down and goal now for the Sooners. And Brown is stopped again by that tough Missouri D. That was Van Alexander.
You see Bobby Stoops pointing today. He's kind of looking at his back. Brown saying, bounce that to the outside. Bounce it to the outside, and you have a touchdown. We saw Oklahoma's defense tighten up in the red zone twice, forcing Missouri to kick field goals. Now it's Missouri's opportunity here to try to stop the Sooners. It's a big third down for both teams.
You see that Alan Patrick is checked back in the game. Pleasant offset would be the lead blocker. They'll try that on the left side. Here comes Patrick, end zone, touchdown at OU.
You see him say to Chris Brown, that's what we're talking about. Get it to the outside with our speed, and we're going to score a touchdown. Gutsy call and a confident call to run the football here. And this is exactly what Bobby Stoops wanted to see. Bounce it to the outside, use your speed, get to the corner, touchdown Sooners.
Chase Daniel. Get the ball back after the kick. Trailing by seven as Hartley tacks on the extra point. The number one team in the nation, Missouri, trails favorite Oklahoma by a touchdown in San Antonio. With the holiday season fast approaching, don't you wish that this season could just continue? 1-2, trailing right now. Missouri and West Virginia. The voters watching, the computers getting ready to whir, and who knows where we'll head next. All I can tell you is folks in Columbus are mighty happy along about right now.
Columbus.
They got insurance working.
Columbus, Athens, Los Angeles, Blacksburg, all
LSU,
over the country.
Baby.
LSU.
Do not forget LSU.
Let's
Matt go. Stanford, 20, Cal, 13. Michigan should dial Jeff Tedford, see what he's got going. Here comes Chase Daniel, and he throws that middle screen. 9 yards to Saunders. Now, here we are, folks. Here's the latest edition of Chaos Incorporated.
Latest.
Or who are you going to boost up there now? Georgia sitting on the couch with Ohio State. Would that be something if both of them use that back door to get there? Well, why not?
Needs to be mentioned that 4 and 5 aren't even in their conference championship games. And would that penalize them based on the way people might vote for Virginia Tech, LSU, and USC?
Deflected, intercepted. Picked off on the ricochet. And the big man, Curtis Lofton. This could be a killer. I think Daniel thought there was interference out there.
And remember, it was Curtis Lofton in the first game against Missouri who had a big play, a 12-yard fumble recovery for a touchdown. This time, it's off a tip pass by Martin Rucker, and he almost takes it to the house again. This guy always seems to be around the football making big plays.
Curtis Lofton, 3 for a loss, the interception. And again, if you weren't with us, and here's the handoff now, and Brown slashes to the 4-yard line. Lofton, 138 tackles, more than Rocky Kalmus or Ted Lehman had for Stoops. And Bob told us he's the most productive linebacker he's ever had. And against Missouri in that first game, he had 18 tackles and that 12-yard fumble return that Kirk spoke about for a touchdown.
Well, the instincts are amazing. Sees everything just a step faster than everybody else. And that time, he happened to be in the right place at the right time. The ball was thrown high to Rucker, who's usually very sure-handed. Bounced off his hand and just went up in the air, and here's Lofton waiting for it.
I think Coach Pinkel said it well. He was wide open. That is the word from upstairs. Touchdown! Jermaine Gresham, his 11th touchdown of the season. And for the first time tonight, a 2-touchdown lead for Oklahoma.
Now, Connell Davis, number 2, gets lost here. I think Missouri's expecting the run. Look at the linebackers stepping up into the line of scrimmage, and Grisham's able to easily get to the back corner where there are no Missouri defenders. They have to take Brown out, and it opened up the play action. Nice call by the Sooners.
Hartley tacks on the extra point. Folks, Missouri has not beaten Oklahoma since 1998. Gary Pinkel has never beaten Bob Stoops. And right now, OU has the number 1 team in the nation in trouble again. Toby Keith is happy. Oklahoma fan, country and western star. Mojo Nixon plays some of his tunes, folks. I would tell you, Mojo on that Sirius radio, he's the best western DJ in America. Mojo loves football and NASCAR.
That was a big time wrestler down there, wasn't it? J.R. Ross down there, the announcer.
Hartley with the ball on the tee. Coming out on the 20-yard line. Take us back, Kurt.
Curtis Lofton's been all over the field throughout the entire season for the Sooners, but we want to go back to this last time these two teams played earlier this year in Norman. That was a turning point in the football game. I know the ball was dropped, but presence of mind to pick it up and score a touchdown. And then tonight, always in the middle of the action, the ball is tipped on a wide open Martin Rucker. There's again number 40 for the Sooners making a big play to set up that touchdown by Grisham.
All right, big drive now for Chase Daniel. And Missouri. He's answered the bell all season long, except in Norman. Middle. Got Rucker this time, hanging on for a first and 10. Let's check it down below with Lisa.
And Brent, remember when we spoke to Curtis Lofton earlier this week, he was a die-hard Cowboys fan, Oklahoma State all the way when he was in high school. Thought he would end up playing for Oklahoma State, but he was in the lunchroom one day in high school in the cafeteria. Coach came down and said, Oklahoma State's on the phone. They want to offer you a scholarship. He got to his coach's office. No one was on the line. He tried to call back twice. He couldn't reach him. Within an hour, Oklahoma had called me. Said, you know what, I should probably wait and make a decision. Ultimately, he decided on Oklahoma.
Yeah, and he had a couple of relatives who were Boomer Sooner fans, and the Sooners are forever thankful, and there's a flag. You saw the little pushing there out of bounds.
That's a big personal foul, late hit on the defense, number 16. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run, automatic first down.
Baker.
It wasn't necessarily a malicious hit. It was just the timing of the hit by Baker. Lewis Baker needs to know better than to just a little shove here on Temple. The fact he was 4 yards out of bounds.
Right. Well, nothing to do with it.
That
right,
have
Kurt?
To do with how, huh? How physical it is. That's driving.
I got to look
crazy.
Up malicious in the rule book there this year. First down and 10, folks. West Virginia in trouble. Missouri in trouble. Daniel goes far side, complete. 12 yards and a first down. Saunders.
Look, I thought he might throw to Jared Perry underneath, who was wide open on a kind of a drag route, but he decides to come all the way back to the right. We've seen him do this a few times tonight. It gives you an idea of the arm strength that Chase Daniel has. Do not be fooled by the lack of size as far as the height of this quarterback. He has plenty of arm strength to make every throw on this field.
First and 10, hands it off to the speedster. Macklin got 9 that time. Holmes making the stop on Jeremy.
For those of you not familiar with Missouri and the way they score fast. I know it's a challenge against this Sooner defense, but a characteristic that we've seen from Chase Daniel and this hurry-up offense is that when they get down or when they have the lead, they know one gear. It's called fastball. Up to the line and call the plays and get the ball down the field.
Set the screen with Rucker. Rucker running wide inside the 10, down at the 6-yard line almost. And it'll be first and goal. That's where Harris got him out of bounds.
Last two on this possession, we've seen Rucker get his hands on the ball, design screen. He cuts it back to the outside. And I'll tell you what, Martin Rucker, for a guy as big as he is, he's got some acceleration. He is really a receiver that they flex out, even though he's listed as a tight end.
How impressive is this drive by Daniel and Missouri? Didn't hang his helmet, did he? Jumped right back into the fray, trailing by 2 touchdowns. Inside handoff now, and the Sooners are ready for that play. Stop made at the 9-yard line by Coleman on Temple.
It's tough sledding to run the football down inside. You get inside the 10-yard line against Oklahoma, and the creases in that defense are very narrow, and they're closing fast. It's the red zone that we've talked about the entire game. They've had opportunities and settled for field goals. They have to score touchdowns.
Second down, swing, Oklahoma's all over it. Derek Washington didn't have a chance. Number 40 led the charge.
Got to give Brent Venables and this Oklahoma defense a lot of credit for the adjustments and the speed and just recognizing their keys and flying to the football. There isn't any hesitation. They close in a hurry on this Missouri offense. Every time they get inside that 10-yard line, the Sooners are flying to the football.
Look at the Sooners come off the sideline as they get ready for the fourth quarter. The entire bench empty to come out to the defense at the 25-yard line. Dr. Pepper Big 12 Championship returns after this message and a word from our ABC stations. Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. That's the only way you can describe this season. This is unbelievable.
You know what? I got to give a tip of the cap to you. You said before that game started, whenever everybody says it's a given, look out for the other direction. You called that, my friend.
I've been on the other side.
Good call.
Incomplete. You know, I lived through Villanova, Georgetown. I lived through North Carolina State. I've seen it. I've seen it in the NFL. It's amazing, Kirk.
Third down, they come up with an incompletion. You and I were talking at the break. Is it four down territory yet? As fast as this offense can get up and down the field, I think right now he's got a kicker that he has confidence in. He's never missed a kick in conference play. Don't mean to jinx you, Jeff. But I think he's going to try to take the 3 points as opposed to going for the touchdown here.
He ran one fake last week. This will be a 32-yarder. But I agree with you, Kirk, as to what's about to happen here. He slides it through. Still plenty of time here in the fourth quarter. Kirk, I suppose, number one, Missouri loses this game tonight. Who finds a way? Certainly, I think Ohio State will be one of the teams,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, if you're real quiet, I think you can hear a celebration right now in Columbus, Ohio. Ohio State would be the team right now with Pitt beating West Virginia to be in. If this game holds on,
right,
the BCS is going to implode.
Oh, I love chaos.
This is their worst nightmare in the history of the 10 years. This is as bad as it's ever gotten. Who are you going to put in there?
Well, but you know, bad is in the eye of the beholder.
Right. I mean, chaotic. I mean, this is
let the voters and the computers sort this all out tonight.
No problem.
You know, Georgia's got a shot. Georgia. LSU's going to say, wait a minute, folks. We deserve to go ahead of them, but yes, they lost twice.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah, I mean, Georgia,
Virginia Tech, but they've got the big loss to LSU.
If you look how hot Georgia and USC are playing, the people vote based on how well they're playing right now. Georgia and Kansas didn't even get into their conference championship game.
Well, there's a penalty on this.
It's going to be interesting. Virginia Tech and LSU. If you're LSU, you're sitting there saying, throw us back in there.
Free kick out of bounds against the kicking team. Oklahoma elects their option to take the ball at the 35-yard line. First down.
Gary Pinkel and his defensive coordinator, Matt Eberflus, have to load up the line of scrimmage. You got to beg Oklahoma to throw the football because they're going to try to take as much clock off as they possibly can.
Here's Brown. Crosses the 45-yard line. And Dr. Pepper stats update looks like this. First downs, the Tigers have 23 to OU's 11.
Yeah, you can see the big penalties for Oklahoma. The thing that does not show up there is the one turnover tonight from Missouri, where Lofton made the interception. Big, big turn of events in this football game because it led to a touchdown, but it also really affected the momentum of this stadium and of the Oklahoma Sooners, kind of the swagger that they gained from that play.
There was movement. There's a penalty called, and this looks like it's going to be a free play. It looks like the defense was in the neutral zone as Iglesias is thrown out of bounds now.
Offsides on the defense. That penalty's declined. Yards is enough for a first down.
Cross midfield to the 46-yard line.
If the Sooners wanted a
A penalty here on Christopher, 34. Just a little bump there. Fans reacting here in the stadium to the replay. Missouri, who's relied on their offense all season, now has to have a big play from their defense.
Bradford has plenty of time, goes deep, got a man wide open to the 15-yard line, Jermaine Gresham.
This is part of the risk by loading up, expecting that the Oklahoma offense is out there to kill the clock. It's not real fancy, but it allows the quarterback to have time off of play action. Look how the Missouri defense reacts to that, and they're out of position because they're expecting the Sooners to run the football. A good call in the right time to make the call that time by Kevin Wilson. Got Missouri out of position and threw right over top of them for the big game.
29 yards. And that time, the defense won that particular battle. That was Ziggy Hood, fine defensive lineman. Had a good year for Missouri, making the stop. Eating time off the clock, bringing it down now.
Sometimes I have to continue to remind myself that Bob Stoops is playing with a freshman quarterback in Sam Bradford. Tonight, nothing spectacular, 17 to 23, 205 yards with a touchdown, but just demonstrating all year such good poise, and it's on display again tonight.
And folks, most of this team is back next year as Brown makes his way to the 9-yard line. As you look through this lineup, Kirk told you that Bradford's a freshman. Wide receivers, juniors, freshmen, sophomore. The entire offensive line will be back next year. Joe John Finley is a senior. Now, I'm excluding those who might opt to go to Sunday football a year early. But if you look around this roster, if you were going to get OU, this is the year you better get them, because they're going to be loaded starting next season.
Well, offensively, you lose Alan Patrick and Joe John Finley, but you get DeMarco Furry back.
DeMarco Murray back from the injury. Sensational. He's a home run hitter, folks, and they're playing without him here tonight. Brown to the 4-yard line, and I dare say that if DeMarco Murray had been in the OU lineup tonight, they would have been bigger than a field goal favorite. I know some of you are wondering, how can the number one team be an underdog? Well, when they played in Norman, Oklahoma was a 12-point favorite down there. And the perception of those who put the numbers together, as you see the young man Murray, a home run hitter, is that Oklahoma had the speed and the way they could defend them, and the fact that they have owned Missouri, actually, through the years. I mean, they just show up and they seem to find a way to beat the Tigers. And this would be huge for the Boomer Sooners if they could finish this one off. Brown is stopped at the 4-yard line.
Last few plays, just like they've done earlier, just basically challenging Missouri up front. I think this offensive line from Oklahoma gained a tremendous amount of confidence in their performance last week against Oklahoma State. They were challenged. Their manhood got challenged a bit by this coaching staff, and they showed up and put together a great game and dominated Oklahoma State up front. I think they came into this game with that swagger back that I think they lost against Texas Tech.
Patrick back on the field. The clock moving toward 10 minutes. Play fake, Bradford. Drop. A touchdown pass gets away from Brody Eldridge. Six slips through his fingers.
William Moore, the safety, was put on an island. He either had to make a decision to come up on Eldridge, which he did not do, or sit back in the corner on Grisham, the tight end. He sat back on Grisham, making a very easy throw for Bradford, who had an open receiver on Eldridge, and Eldridge simply dropped the football.
Now third and goal for Bradford and the Sooners. Touchdown, Boomer Sooner, baby. Number one in deep trouble now. Finley. Bob Stoops had an edge. He said they're talking up there in the Midwest like this was a fluke down here in Norman. He talked about it to all the writers. He talked about it to the broadcasters. I'm sure he talked about it to the team. He said, let's prove that we were indeed a better football team. And as of right now, folks, you can't argue, Gary.
How fitting for Joe John Finley. Two touchdowns last week and another big one tonight.
Three touchdowns, the last three Oklahoma possessions. Hello, Fiesta Bowl. They need to strike and strike quickly. The last two Oklahoma kickoffs, by the way, have been touchbacks, and Hartley getting stronger and stronger, and reality probably starting to set in here for the number one ranked team in the country. In case you're wondering, the number one team since the BCS was instituted has been an underdog on two previous occasions. This will come out on the 20. One of them was a championship game in the Sugar Bowl. Florida State lost as number one to the Gators. Let's bring in Chris Spielman down below. And I want to go back on the Warriors, Hawaii, because Chris, you were over there with Sean McDonough. You guys were covering the Warriors. You've seen them up close. What kind of a football team are they? How good is this Hawaii team?
Well, I think they're as good as they advertised. Cole Brennan is not a throw that he can't make, Brent, and their receivers are on the same page. No receivers do a better job of reading coverage than the Hawaii Warrior receivers.
Incomplete. It'll be third down and 10.
Spills, I want to ask you, if this score holds up, West Virginia's already lost. Who do you think the two teams in the BCS championship should be?
Well, if you go by the numbers, obviously Georgia should jump up there. But when you look at LSU and what they did today, a lot of people will be clamoring for that because they're the SEC champions. Georgia didn't even win the championship of the conference. How do you justify them going to the BCS national title game? Certainly a valid argument.
Yeah, and two triple overtime losses. That's not bad. Kirk, what about you? Who would you vote for?
Obviously, Ohio State is in there. I think Georgia and USC, the two of the hottest teams in the country, but I agree. Georgia not getting to an SEC championship game. I would give LSU the edge. I would have Ohio State and LSU matching up in New Orleans.
Daniel looking for an open man in trouble, eludes the defensive tackle, and steps out of bounds and throws it away.
How about you, Mr. Musburger? Who would you put in there?
All right, Carter.
Come on, Hawaii. Who are you going to put in?
Well, the Buckeyes and,
Hawaii. They're the only unbeaten team left.
On record.
They answered it. Let them go play the Buckeyes.
Yeah,
they deserve it. The heck with it. Yeah. Let them go play, man.
Heading to the island soon?
I am, as a matter of fact. I am going over to see some of my buddies over there with the family before I join up with you out west. But, you know, all those teams really have a good argument. I guess I really have to lean, if not to the unbeaten, LSU, because both those losses now in triple overtime.
Took six overtimes for LSU to lose two games. You stack that up. I think voters should forget about last week's ballot and just look at who you think is most deserving right now based on their accomplishments throughout the year.
You know, Lisa, she told me she wants Penn State in the Alamo Bowl. She's the only one who got her wish. Her alma mater is coming here to play, and perhaps against Texas A&M. We're going to have to wait until it all shakes out. If the Big 12, as expected, gets two teams in, and Oklahoma closing in, and the other one figures to be Kansas right now. And down at the 39-yard line is Smith. So we will take a break. We will continue our conversation here as the favored Oklahoma Sooners lead the number one team in the nation, the Missouri Tigers. You're watching ESPN on ABC. Amazing, you talk about the hot teams, and certainly Pete Carroll's got the Trojans rolling again.
Yeah, and you would expect if they lose out on getting into the championship game, obviously they're going to go to the Rose Bowl.
Right.
And you start to try to put together these BCS games and project out who might go where, and you could start to pretty much align almost every game, assuming Hawaii. Hate to assume, but if Hawaii can beat Washington, you could, with the exception of the championship game.
You're teasing us now.
All right.
Talk me through. Take me through all of them.
Let's, for you and I.
Yeah.
Because you and I think you said Hawaii. For my argument, I say LSU. Okay?
Yeah, that's
so
fine.
Ohio State, LSU, in the national championship game.
Okay.
then you would see an Orange Bowl with Virginia Tech and West Virginia down in Miami.
Agreed.
I think the Rose Bowl in Pasadena would probably be Georgia playing USC.
Pretty good game.
The Fiesta Bowl, I think, would be these Oklahoma Sooners taking on the Kansas Jayhawks.
Right.
All right, we have one more we got to work out.
That's right.
The Sugar Bowl. LSU is now out of the Sugar Bowl.
One-on-one. Penalty, automatic first down on interference. No question about that. Terrell interfered with Kelly, attempting to make the pass as the Sooners probe deep against Missouri. You know, there is a team we've forgotten about here tonight, and that's Arizona State.
On the defense, they number three. A 15-yard penalty from the previous spot.
Let's take another look at this, Kirk, on this interview. I thought it was pretty obvious on the far side.
Yeah, and it's, again, showing Kevin Wilson's aggressive nature. Close to 7 minutes remaining in this game, up by 18 points. Missouri has everybody up to stop the running game of Chris Brown. And I talked to the officials about pass interference before the game. They said if the defender's head is not turned back, he will get called almost every single time. When it comes to interference down the field, if he has not looked back for the football.
The one inviolate rule of the BCS, no more than two teams from any conference will be going into the BCS Bowls. Therefore, some of you are saying, you know, what about a team like the Gators? Well, if you take LSU and Georgia in, you got no shot to get the third team in, which could, in effect, make Illinois eligible, along with Arizona State.
If Arizona State wins and up on Arizona right now, they would have a very strong argument. The other thing to remember is if Ohio State ends at one, the Rose Bowl would have the first selection. And if LSU, for argument's sake, ends up at two, then the Sugar Bowl would have a chance to pull out because of losing their representative. So
at the very worst, they could take LSU to come out and play USC. I mean, you talk about a hot bowl, USC against either Georgia or LSU.
Yeah.
Huh? I might show up and watch that one with you. The granddaddy. Certainly. Bring him in. Georgia actually played in a Rose Bowl. I think it was back in the 40s. LSU thought they were going last year. And then things got juggled around. Just like, you know, it seems like, Kirk, doesn't it seem to you like every year on this final Saturday, something crazy happens. So it's third down and short now for the Sooners. Brown to the 9-yard line. So Bob Stoops just continues the tradition at Oklahoma. But before we continue to praise Caesar at much, let us not forget about the job that Gary Pinkel and his staff have done this year at Missouri. And all the great joy that this team has brought the long-suffering Tiger fans. And I know the one hump they can't get over is beat the Sooners. Since 1983, the Tigers have beaten Oklahoma only once, and they're not going to get it done here tonight, it doesn't appear, barring any miracle. And we're closing in on 5 minutes. But Gary Pinkel and his staff deserve congratulations. And should they not make a BCS, and again, Kansas, with only one loss, seems to be the apple of the Fiesta Bowl's eye. Should Missouri not make it, the Cotton Bowl would be a possible destination for them, and be a great bowl for this team. And I know how disappointed you are when you get this close, you know, to play, and it's so tough to get here.
And I know that these kind of seasons sometimes come around once in a lifetime, not just the results in the field, but when you talk to these coaches about the chemistry during practice and in meeting rooms, how much joy they've had this year with this football team. It's a tough pill to swallow.
There's a play fake. Bradford incomplete. Jojon Finley, who's been active tonight as a receiver.
Touched on Gary Pinkel, and we've talked a lot tonight about the Sooners, how young they are, the job that Bob Stoops has done. Now, remember, 5 of the last 8 years, the Sooners have won the Big 12 championship with 5 different quarterbacks. That just says a lot about the job that Bob Stoops and his staff and the continuity that they have been able to build up in Norman, Oklahoma.
Go, 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 go. Here's Patrick looking the clock. Twisted back in bounds. Howard making the stop for Missouri. So,
remember 1998, UCLA
was number one.
Miami,
they had the Hurricane
Kansas
game.
State.
Miami beat them.
Yeah, Edgerrin James
UCLA.
Had the big game. So that 98 was probably the closest thing that we've had, but not an entire season the way we've seen it this year.
So here's Hartley for the field goal from the right hash. Tacks on a little frosting for OU. Bradford, what a freshman year he has had for the Sooners. And the Mizzou players are going across the field to shake hands. Gary Pinkel is out there with Bob. And Pinkel now congratulating some of the players. And there's Sam Bradford. Automatic BCS bid. Their anchor goal is the Big 12. Coach Gary Pinkel is with Lisa. Lisa?
Coach, the game was tied at half, but the second half, a whole different story. When did the game start to really get away from you?
Well, we made a couple mistakes in there, obviously. You know, we got field goals in the red zone. They got touchdowns, and they played excellent. I think you got to give them credit.
Now, you were never really able to slow down their offense. What problems were you having defensively slowing them down?
You give up big plays, and some penalties, those things happen.
And Chase, we've seen what he can do all year long. Why was he never really able to get comfortable tonight?
Well, I think, you know, again, they did a great job of holding us to field goals. We got three field goals instead of touchdowns. And you give them credit. They're a very good football team, and we didn't do the things we need to do to win.
Now, you were telling us before the game that this was the biggest game of your career. So this has got to be, one of the most disappointing losses of your career. What will you say to your guys in the locker room?
Well, you got to play better. You got to play better in the second half. You got to – we had mental errors. We had penalties, some critical penalties. And, we'll be better at it next time. And
still, congratulations on a great season.
Thanks.
Brent.
Gary Pinkel, class act. He's done a terrific job up at Missouri. Hats off again to Bob Stoops and the Oklahoma Sooners, the 2007 Big 12 champions. They have won 5 of 6. And Stoops remains unbeaten against Missouri. And now the Sooners will head to a BCS bowl. For Lisa Salters, Chris Spielman at Kirkhope Street, I'm Brent Musburger. So long from San Antonio, everybody.